Sometimes it's pretty tough to get up in the morning, isn't it? Because you're facing the exact same scenario as Groundhog Day. Every single day it's exactly the same issues, everything. And he's like, "Are you kidding me? You know, I want to have a, you know, some revelation." So it's really tough, isn't it? But we have to dig in, and there is some glimmer of light this morning, and that is full stop on the wow. There's a way to simplify it and look at it like this: say, don't pursue anything when you're in full stop on the wow. No pursuit is taking place. Not even a pursuit of enlightenment or peace or happiness, bliss. No pursuit at all is taking place. Okay, drop all pursuit. This is full stop in the wow. Easy way to think of it. Of course, if you have no pursuit, you have no momentum, right? There's no momentum at all. This is the self. This is what we are. We're not in pursuit of anything. This whole world is pursuit, is it not? Of course it is. You don't think that the birds, you watch the birds, you don't think they're pursuing food? Pursuing something? Everything is all this motion is pursuit. They're pursuing. Pursuing. Drop all pursuit of truth, of anything. Because pursuit of truth is just the same delusion, right? That we don't already have it. It's like we're wandering around searching, where is it? And it's right here. But we're pursuing. So if we're pursuing something, we can't realize zero momentum of what we are, the freedom of what we are. We think first we have to pursue something, to find what we are, to get what we are, to get food. Zero pursuit. Drop all pursuit. Do not be in pursuit of anything whatsoever. And hanging around those who are all constantly in pursuit is very difficult, is it not? Because they waste their days in pursuit. And they never stop for a moment, actually. Most minds, most here in this world, not even for an instant do they ever stop some sort of pursuit. They're always in pursuit, constantly. So how, and so they, that's the example they set for everyone. And so how are you supposed to, you get pulled along by that? They have no remedy whatsoever. Most in this world don't have even the slightest clue of what the remedy is for what ails us. Not even the faintest clue do they have. And yet we're supposed to hang around that? But what is that? That's why Longeva says, look, spend your time in a cave. Don't try to get friends. Don't try to, you know, it's that doesn't benefit you at all. Because they'll just pull you into pursuit.
Not go to mass anymore.
Not going.
No, Jesus not feeling.
He's not being on one.
Later we go to diet.
You can go, yeah. I don't watch. Okay. Okay. I want to watch a basketball game. I don't want to watch a basketball game 7. Oh, what is it? Pursuit. Frantic pursuit. See, this is what is ruinous for us. Frantic pursuit. We assume that the body is naturally in pursuit. It is not. So this is really key to hear this. Everything the body seems to be is being projected upon it by the mind. But since everyone is projecting this upon the body, pursuit, trying to find something, get something, momentum, trying to establish momentum actually. Isn't everything here giving a picture of trying to establish momentum, process? Indeed it is. Since all bodies seem to be doing that, we assume that this is the nature of the body. And Jesus tells us, no, it is not. The body is actually neutral. It doesn't have any nature to it. It doesn't have any momentum to it. Those around Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma didn't want her to help them, teach, show them the truth and teach them, witness to it, her body would just turn into just a complete inert rag doll on the floor. She's saying the body doesn't have any will of its own, any nature of its own at all. So I'm only here to teach. If you don't want me to teach, they assume that the body would just continue on functioning. She says, no, the body, everything is a projection upon the body. I'm projecting compassion, teaching compassion upon the body. Or actually, you are. She says, you're projecting your desire for teaching upon this body. She says, I'm not projecting anything on it. So if you don't project your desire to be taught, to be witnessed to, then this body has no functioning at all. So literally, the truth of what Jesus said was, Sri Anandamayi Ma showed this as truth. Body has no self-nature whatsoever. None. Of course, this frightens us. Why? Because we're telling ourselves the arrogant lie that God created us to change reality. Okay, this is an arrogant lie. And our job is to repent from this arrogant lie. This is our job. It's just simply an arrogant lie that we are trying to stuff this lie, force it upon God. We're trying to force this lie upon God. It says, God, this is now your will. God created us actually to be absolutely free, formless freedom. Pure freedom in the now. And we're trying to say to God, God, you created us to change that and to be fixed, fixated, and crystallized, and not free, and bound with momentum, with pursuit. This is not true. It's an arrogant lie that we're... It has had no effect on God whatsoever, none. So, is God angry? No. There's no effect. How could it be? God be angry if there's zero effect? We haven't changed God's will in the slightest bit. God knows we're still perfectly free. Everything is still perfectly free. Nothing has ever left its own intrinsic spaciousness, the intrinsic spaciousness that is. Nothing has ever happened in terms of changing reality or fixation. But this arrogant lie and the continuity of fear surrounding it, this is what we have to point out. It's an arrogant lie, and we have to repent from this. And this is how I see it. This is how I feel. This has teeth to it. You know, you can feel it. A lot of the other teaching to me, it's too watered down. It leaves so much wiggle room. And this is what's happened in the world. People are lost. They say, I don't know what teaching. I don't know what. Start with, we're repent from the arrogant lie that we're telling. Okay. That the body has some self-nature to it. And that we're designed to try and change reality, to have nature to ourselves. We don't have any nature to ourselves. We're completely free of nature. There is no nature, actually. Freedom is not a nature. Okay, it cannot be defined at all. So we are all pursuing an arrogant lie, trying to force this false will upon God, saying, God, this is your will. That's it. And so if we just accept, yeah, that we need to repent from this and see it the right way, instead of seeing it the arrogant way, see it the right way. And this is what is lacking in the world. Repentance is lacking in the world. Jesus says you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven unless you repent. You must repent. John the Baptist said this. You must repent. I did a video, Dharma Kik Darshan, Jamyang Kenzi Chogyi Lodro. And he was an action emanation, so to speak. This is what we need. I've noticed that Longchenpa also responds quickly. The action emanation is what we need right now in the world of truth. Because we need to take some actions in terms of helping others. There's big trouble coming. Very big trouble coming. So it's great to have these action teachers. Now, does this mean that I'm a Tibetan Buddhist? No, not at all. I'm a Wowist, a Course in Miracles Wowist is what I am. A Jesus Christ Wowist. A Jesus Christ Wowist, just a truth Wowist. It's the teaching I have is the emphasis is different. Is different, but it reaches the exact same realization. But they're compassionate bodhisattvas are action, compassionate action oriented. This is super helpful. We don't know how to take right action here. We're very, very poor at that. Very bad. These action Dharma kings are very good at it. They have know-how. They have know-how. So they show up. They're committed to helping. So I'm not, I haven't lost my clarity in terms of what Jesus has taught me. It's better than ever. At the same hand, we need to understand there's trouble with China coming, okay, in this world. There's trouble. And the Tibetans understand trouble with China very well, okay? So they're supremely helpful, and we absolutely welcome them, their help. We absolutely welcome their help. They have tremendous know-how. Pretty much that's, I guess in that area, this is something that is conducive to really gaining just super, super overview and know-how. They have it. The Dharma Kings really have it. Especially the Tibetan Dharma Kings, they have tremendous know-how in miracles. They're very, very adept and comfortable with miracles, all variety of miracles, and they really have a comfort zone with action in this world. Okay, whereas we tend to be more abstract and theoretical, but we kind of say, well, "What do we do? What do we do? I don't know what to do." So we welcome the wonderful synthesis there and what's the word? I don't know. We welcome them with gratitude and elation that they're part of the team. We welcome their teamwork. It's just one team of compassionate help and action. There's trouble with China coming. There's no question about it. In many, many, many ways. There's lots of trouble coming in this world. In many, many ways. As this obsession with pursuit And the quote Dharma is just the focus on truth, the cultural, personal, the overall will to repent is what you would call the Dharma. It's the will to repent. Okay, so we have to use, instead of using our will to try and force a false will upon God, we use our will to repent from this effort that we made. Try to force a false will on God. We try to change reality. We try to say we're greater than God. We can change reality. So we tried to force a false will. We said, God, this is your will now, that you created us to change reality. This is not true. This is not true at all. We don't have any self nature. The self is freedom. It doesn't have a nature to it. All of this nature is attempt to change reality, actually. Bodies, worlds, universe, all of this, the way that we are viewing it, the way we see it, is our attempt to change the will of God. Now, we can see it a different way, which is see it the vision of oneness, or an intrinsic, clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, the bliss body. And when we see it that way, we see, oh, okay, this reflects now my desire not to try and change the will of God. So it's just mere ornamentation, decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. Beautiful, beautiful decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. So we can literally see the universe and the world and bodies in that way. Different perception. That's the Ferrari in our driveway. This is the repentant vision that comes from repentance. From using our will in a different way to back up, back away from trying to change the will of God. Back away from futility. There's a perception that then enables us to, that reinforces this repentance. So the vision of repentance is a great way to put it, actually. Vision of repentance. So these Dharma kings, they love those who are committed to compassion, action, and here to help. They're ecumenical. They don't, you know, they know it's all labels. Okay. They're looking at the will. Do you have a repentant will? That's what they're looking for. Are you committed to the vision of repentance? Are you using your will towards that, you know, not in pursuit of it, but allowing it. Allowing it. It's already there. Everyone has that Ferrari in the driveway. It's already there. We don't need to manufacture it, construct it, empower it. We don't need to empower the Ferrari. It's already there. What do you get? It's already empowered. The key is already there. We get in and we say, okay, engine start up. Boom, it starts up. Voice activated, mind activated. It's already there. God placed it there. Holy Spirit placed it there. God, the Holy Spirit placed this vision of repentance, which is they call it the bliss body. It's really the vision of repentance, but we call it the bliss body. It's already there. Everyone has it in their driveway. They're wandering around. Well, where is it? I can't see it. It's right there. What do you mean? It's like, imagine someone coming out and wandering around the driveway and says, "Hi, you know, I don't have any car. You know, where's my car? I can't find my car. I don't know anything. What are you talking about? You must be crazy." And they're like wandering right beside it and bumping into it. It's right there. But their desire to change the will of God has them overlook it. They refuse to acknowledge it. They say, "Well, that can't be mine. It's not mine. It doesn't belong to me. So where's my car? You know, where's my..." It's absurd. So they see that the Ferrari is something that they need to change, they need to get rid of it. So ignoring it is how they get rid of it. They think, if I just ignore it, I get rid of it. Just like, say, if we just ignore God, God get rid of God. If we ignore God's will, we get rid of it. So the skill that we've developed is to ignore reality. That's arrogance. Isn't ignoring reality and thinking that this causes reality to be annihilated? Isn't that arrogance? How could it not be? So, there's no question that Christianity, the focus is on the vision of repentance. Repent. They're speaking about arrogance. Repent from sin, which is arrogance. And this is, of course, in miracles. Jesus really focuses on this. He says it's your spiritual pride. It's, yeah. So this is how I ha see it, and I think it's a tremendous teaching. It's a tremendous focus. So it's an accurate focus. It's one that I prefer. Without it, I feel a little bit like confused. Because, like, well, what? How did all this? Why nature? Why is this nature? Why are there bodies? Why is it? Jesus answers this very, very clearly, adamantly clearly. All of this is a play of arrogance. And we've gone over and over this. And so it should be sinking in, sinking in. We don't want to get lost in labels here as we're talking. We want to wow what we're hearing. The vision of repentance. Okay, vision of repentance is that Ferrari. So commit to the vision of repentance. And everybody else say, well, you're saying I'm arrogant. Absolutely. The world is pursuing arrogance, is an arrogant mindset. Totally. Are the Chinese arrogant? Absolutely, they're arrogant. The U.S. arrogant? Absolutely. Is most people in the world arrogant? Absolutely, they are. They're pursuing an arrogant objective, changing reality. You might think, well, there's all these great masters in Tibet. How come the Chinese were able to, push them out and take over? That's a good question, isn't it? And the answer is, the teachers can only point out the path, repentance to us, but they can't force it. You can lead a horse to water, you can't make the horse drink. So Jamyang Chogyi Lodro, Kyentse Chogyi Lodro, pointed out that, look, this is what's coming. Okay, this has been known that this is going to happen, but it doesn't have to happen if you repent. Accept the vision of repentance, it'll be a different story. So do these things that will help you do that. Tibetans are very adept at using expedience to help out. They're so, they just, their whole mind is, what can we do? What kind of expedience can we do? Put a stupa here, put a statue of the Buddha here, do this kind of prayer, do this. These are all things to help us, with our repentant will, to move us toward the vision of repentance. Reminders, encouragement. So they're very good at that. So that he said, if you do this, it's going to help out a lot. And they didn't do it. So this is the reason why. That means that the will of the people is still arrogant. They have not, so if we haven't accepted the vision of repentance, the bliss body, we are still caught up in the dance of arrogance. And so we will be pushed around by it various ways. And so the bottom line is, events in this world do seem to keep happening in ways that you say, wow, how come that happened? That's terrible. We're not going to try and explain it too much right this instant, but just to hear this, say, oh yeah, wow, how come the Tibetans all got forced out of their homeland there? maybe we'll be forced out of the world, you see. But is that a bad thing? If the Tibetans being forced out of Tibet, was that a bad thing for the world? Actually, it was helpful. Because it sort of basically shamed us all. Really, you look at how they pursue the vision of repentance, and you realize, wow, we're just pathetic dilettantes, you know? Really. So we owe a great amount of gratitude to the Tibetans because how they shamed us so badly. I know that's been helpful for me. Just in a osmosis sort of way. It's like, you know, Longchenpa, he spent his whole life, you know, meditating in caves, and you know, they do these recitations 100,000 times, and you know, they go on 3-year retreats, and we go like a week of retreat. They go 3-year retreat. And it's like, what? It's just like, oh my gosh, we're just pathetic, you know. Our will is just pathetic in the path of, in the acceptance of repentant will, the acceptance of it, of dropping pursuit, as we practice getting used to no pursuit, zero momentum. We have to practice getting used to zero momentum. There's a continuity fear, so practice is necessary in that regard to evaporate. We don't establish the bliss body, okay, the vision of it. We don't do anything. It's already there. But we can't experience it as long as we're pursuing it. Because if we pursue it, we're automatically saying that somehow it's not there, or there's some dynamic that is running away from us. It's not. So we can only experience truth when we stop pursuing it. The bliss body, the vision of repentance. We can only experience that when we truly stop pursuing it. Jesus calls this the holy instant, where you drop all thoughts, he says. All thoughts are just pursuit of something, right? It's just action and pursuit. You can only experience the bliss body when you stop pursuing the bliss body. So the Tibetans have a long history now you know, like 1,200 years or so, but it's of working on this, of practicing no pursuit, of getting used to no pursuit, and thus experiencing the bliss body. Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro was experiencing the bliss body all the time. So as they were chased out of Tibet, these teachers began to travel all over the world. Many of his students were the ones that Dilgo, was it Dilgo Kinsey Rinpoche, or whatever the name is. There are many, he had many, many students, and they're the ones who have been traveling the world over the last 56 years or so, right? And bringing it, they were, you know, a very integral part of the 60s, the spiritual revival of the 60s, right? Because China came into Central Tibet and chased him out in 1959. Okay, so the 60s, they were all these, you know, lamas, rinpoches, tulkus, etc., kenpos were moving around and traveling around the world and saying, hey, you know, that was the 60s. So you have this very potent blend in the 60s. And we started to become familiar with Tibet. Before, it was like the hidden kingdom. Really, nobody really knew much about it. It was like isolated from the world. Because they really didn't want to hang out with us dilettantes, right? You can't blame them. They said, wow, the world is so arrogant. They're pursuing arrogance instead of repentance. So we don't really want to hang out with that. And so we didn't really know very much at all, really. It was, you know, Shambhala, you know, the mystical Nicholas Roerich went there, and the strange dances they do, which are really not that strange. They're just acting out various historical events and I mean, Guru Rinpoche, Pamasamava came and chased out the spirit of arrogance there, the demons, or you call it spirit of arrogance, and help purify it, and history of helping purify the land from the dynamics of arrogance. They act that out in dances, you know, with these monstrous kind of masks and everything, the sounds and everything. But it's you know, it seems very exotic, and so we think, you know, oh, it's very shamanistic and exotic and all that kind of stuff. But that's just the superficial face of it, you know, the stuff you put in National Geographic or something like that. That's not the real heart of it at all. It's these people meditating in caves for their whole life. That's the heart of it. These great Dharma kings that arise out there. These great gurus and great, you know, these masters. They really get after, they really practice non-pursuit. So the Chinese said, okay, we're going to pursue you. We're really into pursuit. We're going to pursue you. And they said, well, I'll tell you what. We're going to go around the whole world and teach non-pursuit. And that's what they've done. So, in doing so, as the 60s developed, and the 70s, we started to become aware, like, of these teachers vaguely, and you hear stories like this, you know, from childhood, that they enter the monastery, they enter the teaching, they're meditating, and we hear these stories like these people meditate, and what they do, it's like their whole lives are meditation. That's all they do. It's just, they're like, what? Now, we know the Christian mystics did the same, don't we? But we thought, well, we've kind of grown out of that, you know, we've sort of, our arrogance has sort of pushed that aside. But then here's this whole body of Tibetans that are, you know, so many are like the Christian mystics, pursuing their whole life in meditation, contemplation, of setting down pursuit, accepting zero momentum of the bliss body. And they're right here, right now, like, what? Shaming us. And we want to be having fun, you know, getting our daddy's car and going to the hamburger stand now and driving to the beach, and, you know, just, you know, we want to live a life of sybaritic fun. And here they are, you know, meditating morning, noon, and night in caves, a little fire there, and picking berries for food, and doing constant empowerments and rituals and everything they can do to encourage themselves to repent, vision of repentance, to allow it, to feel that this is okay, I can allow this, I can accept this. So we're looking at this, and it's just, you know, I felt like, man, I'm just a pathetic amateur, you know. So, a couple nights ago, I had a dream of Dharma King, John Young Kenzie, Choki Lodo came to visit me and embraced me, and it was just overjoyed. It was just amazing. I didn't know in the dream. I wasn't sure who it was. I said, what is this? Well, his one of his goals was to bring this diligence to the West, this intensity of practice to the West. And so apparently he was showing how happy he was with my diligence in practicing, that, you know, it's bearing fruit. You know, he's just very, very overjoyed, because I do get after it, you know, 24/7, and have lived a life of more and more and more and more diligence, never miss a day. You know, it's kind of like you don't want to be shamed, but like you're like just some wretched amateur. I mean, who wants to feel that way? I mean, they, again, so the Tibetans really, by putting us to shame, have helped us so much. It's like Tiger Woods with golf. You know, you see him play golf, you say, oh my gosh, I'm just a wretched, you know, wretched. This is, it puts you to shame. And it what makes you want to improve your game. Really, it does. So I don't, you know, I don't feel put down. I feel that the shame is a very positive emotion to feel. It's like, wow. I don't want to feel shame forever. And the way the arrogance deals with the way the world deals, it's just to ignore these teachers. It's no shame, so I feel fine. I'm happy now. I don't feel. This is, of course, arrogance. Because we just stay with our arrogance then, stay in pursuit. The truth isn't here right now. Yeah, we're pursuing it. How do we deal with truth except to say we're pursuing it? Is that the most of the world, they don't like to be shamed. You know, they want to feel the lowest common denominator. Let's ignore all the great teachers. Forget them. And this is the plan of arrogance, to be happy. And most people think, of course, that's going to work. Why? Because we want it to. So, trying to change reality, we think this is going to make us happy. It's like trying to change happiness. We think that's the new happiness. Except you can't change happiness. So there's this feeling of futility, and then we tell ourselves, well, we just have to be happy with the feeling of futility, as if we could just will that. I can be happy with the feeling of futility. And then just ignoring any examples to the contrary. So we ignore the red Ferrari in our driveway. Ignorance. As Buddha said, the problem is ignorance. But ignorance doesn't mean stupidity. Ignorance means a willful ignoring. Our ignoring is willful. Nobody's stupid. The problem is just arrogance. It's not stupidity at all. So you have to get away from the notion that the problem is stupidity. There's no stupidity anywhere. It doesn't exist. It's all arrogance, which is willfulness, which is willful ignoring, which is trying to say, God, my will is now yours. Okay, not that yours is mine. Mine is yours. And I want to change reality, so that has to be your will too. This is arrogance, and it's futile. So to get a recognition from Dharma King, Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, to get recognition from him in this way, I didn't ask for it or anything. He took it upon himself. He's saying, yeah, that he's thrilled that the example of the Tibetans has been helpful. That the example they've set of practicing zero momentum, accepting the vision of repentance, practicing accepting it, the non-pursuit of it, the perfect non-pursuit of it. See, is like Ramana said, it's all about non-pursuit. Drop the search, drop the pursuit, drop the effort, drop trying to establish it, drop trying to attain it, drop trying to find it, drop it. That's all pursuit. Drop all effort. Do absolutely nothing, and there it is. So truth only dawns upon us, the bliss body, when we stop pursuing it in any which way. And we have to practice the non-pursuit of it, meaning getting used to it. So he's thrilled that the example that he set and all those that he's part of this great transmission lineage and practice lineage, or practice familiarity, you might say. He's thrilled. He's thrilled. He's thrilled that it's helping. You see? super happy, just thrilled. I'm thrilled that he's thrilled. I'm thrilled that he's thrilled. You know, if you're trying to set an example for others, and you see someone who's benefited from that, you know, aren't you going to be thrilled by that? I mean, and that's the rarest thing in this world, isn't it? The rarest thing to find is anyone who actually follows the example of the Dharma kings, who actually follows their example. That's the rarest thing there is in the world. It's the hardest, because most of us don't do it. We keep waiting for a pharmaceutical pill, actually. We keep thinking arrogance will help us out. Because arrogance is saying, oh, yeah, we can do this. Of course, we can take care of this by just defining it a certain way. So we just say, we'll just redefine reality. Of course, reality doesn't have any definition. So there's nothing to redefine. But we say, no problem. We'll just define that there is something to redefine, and then redefine that. And then we're just dealing with concepts, you see, and labels, symbols, illusion, as Jesus calls it, illusion. But what the Dharma kings really are, the example they're really setting is practice. Wowing your clarity is the practice. Wowing our clarity is the practice. And there is no other practice out of this. There's many ways that of working on flipping the script so clarity arises. But if we don't have the willingness to wow it, it won't happen. So, but the example they're setting is to wow our own clarity and keep doing this all every day, all during the day, just continually keep at it. This is what they're really all about. Sri Sri Ananda, my mom, what was she about? Practice. Nothing other than that, really. She said, this is what I'm here is to encourage you to practice more. That's it. That's it. The bells and the whistles are helping us flip the script. People say, I want to get some, you know, some experience, a miracle. But if we're not willing to wow it actually works in a negative way. The ego gets a hold of it. Our arrogance gets a hold of it. So our arrogance wants to be empowered. It says, how can we empower our arrogance? How can we do what God can do? How can arrogance do miracles? How can the ego do miracles? The ego thinks, see, we think we have to teach the ego how to do what God does for us. You know, how can the ego develop a bliss body? Well, it can't. The ego only has a futility body, so to speak, which is nothing, of course. But we can call it the futility body. We're all trying to develop a futility body and then be happy with that, which is futility is symbolized label-wise by mental chaos. So we're all trying to develop a futility body. And arrogance says, that's the answer. In other words, be so confused about futility that you aren't able to recognize it as futility, and then it won't be futility. This is the arrogance. This is what it tells us. Magical solutions, as Jesus calls them. Magical belief, magical thinking. That's arrogance. We're enmeshed in this magical belief, magical thinking. So these Dharma kings, they set the example of practicing. And we all think, oh, I practice. I'm so tired. I want to sit down and do a million recitations. No, that's just one style of practicing. Wowing your clarity, I find, is in our modern society, contemporary society, et cetera, this is what works because we have to do it right within the turmoil of our busy lives. We're not really sitting in caves, are we? We can make a cave about us as we wow our own clarity that arises. It's as if we're in a cave, so to speak, right? But it's, you know, the formal stuff where you know, I mean, who could do a 3-year retreat, you know, honestly? I don't know. I guess some do, can't. I mean, who pays for that? I don't know. And who's able to just detach from the world for 3 years in this society? It's like if we stay sick in our house for 2 or 3 days, trying to come out into the world again, it's like, well, what happened? You know, you feel like I'm lost. I've gone through this. You know, if you stay out of the functioning of this world for a prolonged period of time, you feel like you don't fit belong here anymore at all. It is scary that the change is so fast right now. So we have to find the way to succeed in dropping all pursuit of the bliss of bliss body, vision of repentance, drop all pursuit of it. And that's then an experience. Abidance is just zero pursuit. Zero momentum. Pursuit, of course, there's momentum, right? Otherwise, you couldn't label it as pursuit. So don't pursue truth. It's our pursuit of truth that blinds us to truth. It's just arrogance, isn't it? The idea that truth has to be pursued, what is that? It's arrogance. It's saying the truth isn't here right now. It's a very clever way, right? I mean, this is how we do it. Truth isn't here right now, therefore I have to pursue it. But so it's only dropping the pursuit. Zero momentum that we experience the bliss body vision of repentance, bliss body vision of repentance, that shows us that indeed the way that we're able to perceive this reality through perception, reality is actually experienced through knowing. So when we're perceiving, we're still perceiving quote unquote an illusion, but the way we perceive it is intrinsic spacious. We're able to see nothing can possibly be in pursuit of intrinsic spaciousness. And we're able to see this. That, oh, everything is at rest in its own intrinsic spaciousness. So we're seeing zero pursuit, zero momentum in that regard. Okay, and then this then enables us ultimately to just know, the knowing of reality, the great bliss. But this will not be this will not take place while we're still here in this world. While we're functioning, communication, whatever. It won't happen. Jesus says we cannot remain long in this world if we're knowing, not at all. No. So our goal is this clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, the vision of repentance, the bliss body. We see, you see a bird flying through the sky, and we think that it's in pursuit of something. But is it in pursuit of its own intrinsic spaciousness? Does not the bird, no matter how fast it's flying, does it not have the quality of intrinsic spaciousness this instant? And is it not at rest in that intrinsic spaciousness this very instant? Yes, it is. Is not everything. In spite, of course, all of nature is pursuit, momentum, pursuit, right? It's a vision. It's a false dream we're having, trying to give the notion that reality is not here now. And that there's some, you know, we're changing it. Like there's fixation and so it's mirage, a hallucination, a false hallucination. But even the false hallucination is abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness, this very instant, perfectly. It doesn't move an iota from that. So we can see nature as it keeps moving in pursuit, but it's never in the slightest bit. It's always completely at rest in its own intrinsic spaciousness. So this is what Christianity would say, that the peace beyond understanding. At rest, peace, absolute peace at rest, beyond any understanding, because it cannot be understood in terms of all this pursuit, right? It's understood by the vision of intrinsic spaciousness, the vision of repentance. This is the goal. This is our goal. We have a very clear-cut goal. And so we see that as primary, and then all the actions and pursuit is just shadow dancing, you know, kabuki theater is shadow dancing. That's not, perceptually, it's not important. It's still there, of course, we still see everything, but we feel, what we feel is at restness, the at restness. This is how we're able to be in the world, but not of it. That's what Jesus would say, in the world, but not of it. Be in the world, but not of it. So I want to be very clear, everyone, that we're very ecumenical here. However, whatever your practicing is like, continue your practicing. But understand the context of it's going, it's allowing your practicing no pursuit at all. Not even pursuit of practice. And the vision is already there. Holy Spirit put it there. We don't have to establish the vision at all. We don't have to do anything. In fact, it's when we accept we don't have to do anything is when we experience it then. We're not in pursuit of it. Because the intrinsic, nothing's in pursuit of intrinsic. How can anything pursue intrinsic spaciousness? This is absurdity. We can never be apart from it. Doesn't matter how fast we're going. Nothing is happening in terms of our abidance in intrinsic spaciousness. So motion, all this pursuit and motion just seems like an illusion. And what we feel is the peace of non-pursuit that is present, intrinsically present everywhere, inherently so. Everything is abiding in pure spaciousness, and it's not moving in relation to that at all. There's no motion, meaningful motion at all taking place. Okay? It's not like something's here and now it's over here and something meaningful happened in terms of abidance. No, nothing happened in terms of abidance. It's still perfectly in spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness. So this is the vision that we get. This is the feeling we have. This is the bliss that we have. It's like, oh, everything's okay. Arrogance didn't do anything to intrinsic spaciousness. We have just been misemphasizing just seeing motion and pursuit and all of this, what we think is process, but there's no process of leaving intrinsic spaciousness taking place at all. None. Vision of no process. And so we realize that getting used to this then enables us to then ultimately know and truly experience reality the way we were created to experience it. So it's a discipline. We know it's an emphasis. Okay, we realize that. And we know that arrogance is emphasizing motion, process, or pursuit. And so the dream of all this pursuit is there, but we're emphasizing intrinsic spaciousness. So depending on which you emphasize, that's how what you're going to feel. You're either going to feel turmoil, conflict, turmoil, fear, pursuit, momentum, insecurity, stuff, or you're going to feel bliss, depending on what your perception, what you emphasize in your perception. So if you emphasize process, the illusion of process, intrinsic spaciousness will only be a concept for you. It's just, oh, it's just a concept. Doesn't really, I can't feel it. But if you have the vision of repentance where you're seeing intrinsic spaciousness as primary, this is what you're seeing it very clearly, then what you're feeling is bliss, no pursuit, stability, peace, stability, all that. That's what you'll be feeling. That's what we choose. You choose one or the other. So perception is variable in that way. We have a choice of what perception we use. Now, perception isn't ultimately true, either one. But one of them enables us to accept knowing, which is beyond perception, which is our true functionality in reality. The other is just a dead end of mental chaos and instability, and it just doesn't result in knowing at all. The familiarity continuity problem still remains. So it's just it's masochism to keep emphasizing nature, process, to perceive, keep emphasizing this perception, sensory perception, is masochism. It's spiritual masochism is all it is. Yeah. So as Rama said, if you want to keep emphasizing sensory perception, believe your body, you know, fine. He said you want to keep dreaming, then this world, this perception suits your purpose very well. We don't really mean this world. There's two different ways to perceive this world. So this is what Jesus clarified for us. There's two different ways to perceive the world. We have the option to choose one or the other. It's fine. If you want to choose spiritual masochism and suffering, then choose sensory perception, and this is what you'll experience. There's no judgment on that. God doesn't judge. There's no judgment. You just get, that's what you get. You get suffering. And so, what's the question? Did you have to choose one or the other? And the frustration comes from arrogance, says, no, I want to choose futility and arrogance and sensory perception, but I want to be happy with it. Teach me how to be happy. That's impossible. Nobody can teach that. Oh, well, some great teacher. No great teachers ever taught that. No great teachers ever taught how to do the impossible. So they must have arrogance distorts what they say. Say, no, there's a way. No, there's no way. There's no way. There's no way. If we want to be miserable, then we'll be miserable. You can't want to be choose to be arrogant and not be miserable. It's impossible. And of course, arrogance says that it can accomplish the impossible. That's what it's like. So of course, arrogance is going to assess there's a way to do it. So we have to repent. And this is what the world doesn't get. This is what the mindset of this world doesn't get at all. The Christians used to get it. They're desperate. Desperation is a wonderful thing. Jesus shamed us all, which is great. The Desert Father shamed us all. The mystics shamed us all. Yeah, wow. So Christianity used to be a situation where people were profoundly shamed by the saints and really got after it and repented. And now, in this materialist and modern world, as a Christian just recently told me, he says he has a lot of interaction with people on a very basic level of money and asking for donations. And he said they've lost the fear of God. What he's really saying is they've lost that shame of like, wow, I'm not really getting after it at all. I'm just arrogant. I'm not repenting. They're saying, oh, repentance doesn't matter. We'll just define happiness as futility. Futility is happiness. We'll just define it that way. We'll just conceptualize it that way. And that'll work for us. And when it doesn't work for us, we say, well, we'll just define this pill as working for us. And that'll work for us. But that road stops when you experience mental chaos. This is where everyone's going in this world, is to mental chaos. I know it. Because that's where I went. I've been there. I know the road, how it goes. Because you keep asking arrogance. Well, I want the answer now. Come on. I'm tired of this misery. And arrogance ultimately leads us to say, well, mental chaos is the answer. And that's the final answer. Final answer. And then you realize that doesn't work either. And at that point, you say, oh my gosh, arrogance doesn't work. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? And that's when you discover the Holy Spirit, the grace of God. And then you start gradually becoming aware that others have discovered it also and have been liberated, have accepted the vision of repentance. It's still perception. So you can still, if you still function here, it's just that. So when you have the vision of repentance, it's sensory perception is just a concept. Okay, it's still there, but it's just seen as just a concept. As Ramana said, all this stuff, God, salvation, enlightenment, these are all concepts. All these positive, they're just concepts because we're viewing them in a sensory perception way, an arrogant way. So we will just see sensory perception is just all, it's just was merely a concept, that's all. Now, is the vision of repentance a concept? Yes. But it's the concept that removes all other concepts, that frees you from all other concepts. And then from this point, you can drop even the concept of the bliss body. Okay. The bliss body is also a concept, but it's a concept the Holy Spirit has given us that frees us from all other concepts. And then from there, this is what Jesus tells us. So Jesus is a great clarifier, supreme clarifier, actually. Wisdom body. Jesus is the Dharmakaya body, the wisdom body, the Dharmakaya, the wisdom body, the great clarifier. But we also need those who, are focused on the action body also. And Jesus is not so focused on the action because, Jesus, what do I do? What do I do? I never get any answer. I just get clarification, which is, I guess, what he wants us to do at this point. But also because the troubles are coming, I say, well, I do need some, action body clarification also. So the Tibetans seem to have that one covered. They seem to be very active in that. I ask Dharma King Longchenpa for action, a indication that he's present and here and willing to act, and boom, I get a response within 30 seconds or less, sometimes 10 seconds, sometimes 1 second. So he's like Johnny on the spot. These Tibetan Dharma Kings, they're really geared for immediate action, which is what we will be needing coming up. So whatever happens in the world doesn't matter. What happens is, do we have access? Do we have help? Right? That's what's important. I mean, I don't care this tragedy, this thing, some horrible event took place, something to the world today, but there's always, fine. Well, it's a false flag, it was, or not, whatever. Doesn't matter. Because the question is, do I have help? Do I have the right help? That's what I want to know. That's all I want to know. Chamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro. Johnny on the spot. Absolutely. Does he have her back? Does Longchenpa and his vast court, of which Chamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro is certainly part of that overall court of the omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa. He might be the action emanation of it. Really, do they have our back? This is what we want to know. So this is what I'm saying. I'm giving evidence they have our back. This is very reassuring, because if we don't feel we have help, we could very well panic. So this information I'm giving out is very important. And what is important is that the help is there for us, but we have to trust it. So I did videos, trust it. Okay, this is why I did the video, trust it. Now, what's helpful is to see there's someone in the West, a Westerner, they call us Westerners, I don't know why, but barbarians, he's a better term. There's some barbarian, who understands, trusts the help, because they understand what the purpose is no pursuit, practicing no pursuit. So I trust in the help. It's there for all of us, but you have to trust in it to accept it. So I'm trusting in it. But it's a really good, great thing. It's really great for us barbarians. Practice barbarians. We don't practice enough. They view us as barbarians, I mean, rightfully so, because we're still in high-speed pursuit of sensory perception concepts, of following the advice of arrogance, which has us in high-speed pursuit always. So we don't realize that the truth is here now. So we don't perceive intrinsic spaciousness, of course. We perceive the pursuit of it, but not the fact that it's already present. The pursuit of it is blindness to the fact that it's already present. That is the blindness. So we're pursuing blindness, essentially. And we're barbarians in that way. So it's great that there's some barbarian here who's been practicing enough, so I can trust in the help to some extent that's available to us. This is supremely important. So of course I had to up my practicing, so I wouldn't be so shamed by it. and so intimidated by it. The Tibetans can be very intimidating because of the intensity of their practice. We just like, you know. But I'm not so intimidated by it, which is very helpful. Because I get after it, you know, just as much as they do, basically. I'm no slacker. I don't feel like a slacker anymore. I used to, very much so. Because I was just reading. I mean, but I was still getting after it. I mean, I'd read 14 to 16 hours a day, so I've never really been a slacker. But it's the, you know, it's the intimidation factor of, well, we're doing 1 million recitations of this mantra. It takes us 3 years. You know, we've done it 3 times in our lifetime. This kind of stuff kind of is intimidating, but that's just one way of practicing. And it can become robotic. And as Ramaharshi said, look, if you're sick, all, you know, reciting the name of the medicine a million times isn't going to do you any good at all. You got to drink the medicine, or, you know, take the medicine. He's using this as an analogy. It's a very good analogy. I love Ramaharshi and what he says. It's so simple and direct and to the point. He's saying all these practices you're doing robotically, he says that doesn't help you at all. Well, this is, he's making a point. You need to drink the medicine. Okay. So he gets to the bottom line. Ramana's always bottom lines everything, which is very helpful. That is not to say that repeating these mantras isn't helpful. It certainly is. It certainly can be, because you're not doing anything else. So it helps you detach from pursuit of all these worldly ambitions of arrogance, which is really blindness. Really, all that we're pursuing is blindness, as far as arrogance goes. It's just blindness. We're not seeing intrinsic spaciousness. We're trying to blind ourselves to it. Because if we see intrinsic spaciousness, we say, oh, well, we haven't changed reality at all. What are you thinking? Stupid. So, arrogant. So, by saying these mantras and practices, they're not pursuing anything else. And sort of like, as Sri Srinath, my mom would say, it's like God uses a thorn to remove the thorn, a sticker. So the, you know, sticker's in, you know, stuck in your hand. You use another sharp sticker to, you know, to kind of dislodge that sticker. So these spiritual practices, whatever, you know, they can be anything at all, really. But the idea is whatever it takes to back away from all this pursuit of blindness. This is helpful. But what Ramana says is, look, as long as you're pursuing it, you're not experiencing it. So you've got to not drop all pursuit. Yeah, he's bottom lines at all. Drop all pursuit. And he shames us wonderfully. Ramaharshi really shames us. What, how wonderful that is. Just his presence absolutely shames us, which is great. Every time I see him, I say, oh my gosh, I'm so ashamed. I'm so blind. I'm so blind. My blindness shames me. And thank you for shaming me. Thank God that you showed up to shame us all like this. Wow. Potent. Potent. Extremely potent shaming of us, all of us, Ramaharshi. And of course, a miracle shames us all too. Jesus really shamed us with that. It's like, you think you know what you're talking about? Here, read this. It's like, oh my God, I'm an idiot. I'm so blind. Thank you, Jesus, for showing up with giving us A Course in Miracles. It's just like, wow. This is all supposed to be perfectly clear to me? Oh, it's not. Oh my gosh, it is, but it isn't. Oh, you know. It's like, great shaming. So I shame myself with that, you know, for 15 years nonstop. Just, and continue, you know, continuing on. But I really, you know, if you want to talk about getting after it, how about sitting in your room? And I blocked out the windows with boards. It was just dark room, and soundproofed it almost. And I just stayed in this room like almost constantly, except coming out to get something to eat, and I went back in my room. That's all I did for years and years and years, studying A Course in Miracles for 16 hours a day. You know, try that. You know, but there's no Tibetan practitioner that can, you know, top that, really. But they have a culture of practice such that they're able to move about and practice in that way, which is really difficult here. But it's difficult because we don't have the culture of practice. So they have an advantage in that regard. They most certainly do. That's a great advantage. So I have to try harder. You know, but this is the thing in my life is I've always been second, you know, second son. In my schooling, my birthday is such that I was like right near the cutoff date for my class. So I was the youngest in my class. All my classmates were older than me, and that made a difference. I always felt inferior. And I've always been the one who had to try harder. And so I see these Tibetans, holy cow, I mean, they have such an advantage over us because of their culture. The culture of, they have a practice culture. We don't. We have an arrogance culture, a non-practice culture. And so I've had to try harder. You know, I've had to work at it more ferociously. And this was as a result of Longchenpa coming to see me, Jamyang Khyentse Chogyi Lodron coming to see me. They're just like saying, wow. Wow. We love your practice, your work ethic, your practice ethic. Wow. We love it. I was saying, why? Because I still feel, I always feel like I'm way, you know, it's inferior. It's just this inferiority complex in terms of this is how my life has been. No accomplishment, no attainment, you know, nothing. And so, again, in the morning, I say, I got to just like, my house is on fire. I'm way behind. This is how I feel. I got this morning, I say, I'm way behind. And so, I said, I got to get up and just start taping. I got to get after this. This is how I feel. I feel this way. Like, wow, I'm losing. I'm failing. I'm way behind. I'm shameful. I got up and what I see, my screensaver slideshow of Ram Maharshi, I'm paying all this attention to it. And then I go to Ram Maharshi's Facebook page, his timeline, which I highly recommend. It's the best, one of the best web wells. It's just one of the best websites there is. No question about it. I mean, and don't be picky about it, you know, the way they run it, you know, they're doing a fine job. They're doing a great job. And just go through that, the timeline on Facebook around Maharshi and the quotes and the pictures. Oh my God, it just shames you to pieces. And it's wonderful. I really highly recommend that. I should put a link to that in my descriptions of the videos. If I highly recommend something, take it as money in the bank. I'm a Dharma prince. If I recommend something like that, follow the advice. You know, do it. It's super helpful. So if you're on Facebook, just say, oh, my friends, wait a minute. I'm going to go to Ram Maharshi, facebook.com/Ram Maharshi, and just go through the timeline. Look at all the quotes and the comments that people make. And it's just like, wow, that's a super great practice. And you will start losing this feeling like you're an imbecile, you know, like complete derelict. And the thing is, we're so ashamed in the West, or the whole world, really. I mean, let's be honest. The East is shamefully derelict also. Okay? They really are. Let's be honest about here. We're all shamefully derelict. The Tibetans have a practice culture, which is probably the strongest in the world, actually. So, you know, they're a light unto the world in that way about their practice culture. Now, I am not advocating Vajrayana Buddhist practice for anybody by any means, because there's a lot of cultural determinations and stuff why certain practices seem to be helpful and stuff. But I am advocating the practice culture for you. And you can do it right in your bedroom. Go to facebook.com/Ramana Maharshi and look at that timeline. And so when you're doing this, you'll start losing this feeling of dereliction. And when you start losing that feeling of dereliction, what happens is you get better and better at it, because you say, oh, I don't have to practice Vajrayana Buddhism. I'm getting after it right here. So see, Vajrayana Buddhism is very intimidating. There's some, I don't think the Tibetans understand quite clearly. There's some blind spots they have culturally. So I'm helping with that. But they probably understand that. It's inevitable, right? They don't quite understand, quote unquote, the West or the rest of the world. They say, what? A bunch of derelicts. And they're right about that. But they can't understand our dereliction. And so they think, well, these practices work great for us. And they should, so here, let's export them. It doesn't export so well. They're frustrated. No, it does. You cannot export culturally all these practices. It doesn't work. But it's the example, the practice example you're setting, talking to the Tibetans now, that is so important to us. Shame us. It's the shaming of us through your the success you've had and the practice you have. That's what's important. We're going to have our own practices. You have to accept that. I mean, I don't do visualization at all. It doesn't resonate with me at all. I don't do mantra yoga. I don't do Mahamudra mantra yoga. I don't do it. I've never done it. But there's lots of other ways of practice. Wowing your clarity is the heart of all practices, actually. Everything else is like waves on the surface. But when you wow your own clarity, this is managing your success on the path, which is the heart of all paths. No matter whether you use, visualization and mantra yoga, anatara yoga, tantra yoga, whatever you use, or none of that, you still have to manage your success on the path, which is wowing your clarity. This is the same for all paths. So don't think that your practicing is somehow inferior. Because the Buddhist thing is, they say, well, Theravada is inferior practice to Vajrayana or Mahayana Buddhism. Because you can do it one lifetime. You know, there are ways to do it. We're doing it fast, one lifetime. Well, I guarantee you that the practices in the Course in Miracles can get us to the vision of repentance in one lifetime also. And Jesus' practices there don't use it. They're not Vajrayana Buddhist at all. They have to do with changing perception. Of course, they're helping us. But so there are many ways to do it. It's not just Vajrayana Buddhism that's a fast path. There are many fast paths, actually. What is important is the practice examples that the Tibetans set for us. They shame us that way, which is great. So if you're spending time on Ramaharshi's timeline and wowing what you're doing a profound practice, very profound. If you're watching like a darshan video, like I produce darshan, if I produce some more, you're doing a very profound practice, which is speeding up your situation or slowing it down, slowing your pursuit of blindness down greatly. So when you're going to Ramaharshi on Facebook. So many young people, you spend so much time on Facebook. Go to facebook.com Ramaharshi and say, Dharma Prince Clarity Ross sent me here. You know, you can say, Dharma Prince Clarity Ross sent me here. Thank you for having this website. They've done a fantastic job, and there's new stuff being added all the time. It's amazing. You go there every day, there's something new, a lot of new stuff. It's just a spectacular job they're doing. Really, you can't yourself post pictures on it. I don't know who has the right to do all that, but that's okay. They're doing a fabulous job. And it's great spiritual practice to do this. So if you're doing that, do that for 2 or 3 hours. And then do some other practice for 2 or 3 hours, and just keep. And then if you keep doing this, you won't feel so inferior, culturally inferior to the Tibetans. This will help. This will help. Because I know the Tibetans are frustrated because they're trying to like teach people Buddhism and we don't get it. And I'm like, what's wrong with you? But we have a great tradition called Christianity. I don't think they understand Christianity very well. and different traditions. I mean, different things do not necessarily export very well. I mean, just like try to export Christianity to Tibetan Buddhists, it doesn't work, right? And Christian missionaries banging their head, you know, like, you know, it doesn't work. And of course it doesn't work. It's the same thing. You can't export Vajrayana Buddhism to Christians very well, actually. But what you can export is the work ethic, the practice, your ethic of practice. You can export that. And you can shame us that way. You absolutely can. And you can export, like Monk Chempa's teachings are very exportable, because it's touching on the very heart of it. It's, I don't need to do anything, which is what Jesus, the message in the Course in Miracles, we need do nothing. Okay, we need do nothing. So there's a lot of great books in Tibetan Buddhism, so many, but none of them are superior to A Course in Miracles. Okay, none of them are superior. They may be equal to it. Okay, I'll grant that, but none of them are superior. So as far as us feeling like we're like, you know, poverty stricken in terms of written transmissions, we're not poverty stricken at all. I don't feel like I have to get these secret book teachings, books from the Tibetan Buddhists at all. I said, what are you talking about? I have A Course in Miracles. There's nothing better. There's nothing, A Journey Beyond Words. There is no better book that's ever been published anywhere in the world. No better teaching book. Now, there might be hundreds that are just as good, maybe. I don't know. Whether they're secret or not doesn't make any difference. I already have something that's as good as you can get. So I don't feel like I need to pursue, you know, these Terma treasures and these books and stuff, all the stuff that they have. Like, oh yeah, some secret thing, I'm waiting for some translation of it. I don't need to wait for any translation of it. I already have A Course in Miracles by Dharma King Jesus Christ. There's no greater teacher than Jesus Christ. There may be those just as good, but there's none better. That is for sure. Monk Chempa would say, maybe just as good as Jesus Christ, but he's not better. And I find Monk Chempa's teachings complement A Course in Miracles and vice versa, very much so. It's like very helpful. His, you know, his Dzogchen, Hatha Yoga, Apex Yoga teachings are fabulous. Exactly what we need to hear. They just basically say, yeah, what Jesus told us is absolutely correct. Absolutely correct. I don't need to do anything. Drop all pursuit. It's the same as Rama Maharshi's telling us. So these Dharma kings tend to get right to the heart of it. And they don't require us to drop our traditions, our culture, etc. Repent. Repent, repent, repent. You must repent. John the Baptist. This is part of our tradition, Judeo-Christian tradition, which, by the way, go back 6,000 years. So it's not like we're like a bunch of morons who have no tradition. They say, well, our tradition is 1,500 years old or 1,000. Well, we have a tradition that's 6,000 years old. We have an ancient tradition. Judeo-Christianity is an ancient tradition with vast success and wisdom throughout it. And it's materialism that's screwing everything up right now. It's the influx into this world of spiritual materialists. And the reptilian influence in this world is causing the problem. I mean, Christianity used to have massive faith in saints. I asked Jamnyan Kensi Choki Lodo to remove this pain I was having. I couldn't sleep. And in 10 seconds, it was gone. Okay, 10 seconds, it was gone. Well, did I appeal to the pharmaceutical companies and their products, or did I appeal to the saints? I appealed to the saints. And it just shows you that a saint is a saint. Whether it's a Christian saint or a Buddhist saint, it's all the same. The Christians used to rely on saints for their healing and for their healthcare system. The saints were their healthcare system. And they had great faith and massive amount of healings. Whatever, cancer, gone. Arthritis, gone. And Jesus said, your faith made you whole. Your faith in the grace of God that is already present made you whole. So Christianity has a tremendous history and culture. Yeah, we're not inferior. Christianity is not inferior to any tradition, actually. It's just the modern scientific paradigm that has arisen out of Europe. It makes it seem like we're a bunch of morons, but it's not really true. It's not really true. Because we've kind of lost touch with our tradition. We've lost touch with it. Badly, very badly. And I've been trying to help us, not lose touch with it, but it's been ineffective. I mean, the Christian, Judeo-Christian tradition and heritage and culture is really, gone off track. It's been derailed. And there was a great effort to derail it, actually, because it was so profound. So profound. People would go to churches and shrines and pilgrimage sites for their healing and their blessing, and they would get it. But unfortunately, the modern materialistic age has arisen out of that Judeo-Christian culture because of the pagan culture that was there previously, that came roaring back, the arrogant pagan culture, which is giving culture, just arrogant culture of arrogance came back, and pharmaceutical industries rose up. France, Italy, Germany, Great Britain, those countries, that area, chemical, pharmaceutical, biochemical, all that stuff began to arise, science rose there, materialism, and now we have this global culture, pharmaceutical culture, which Jesus prophesies would be the trouble of the end times, is the pharmaceutical culture of the world, where we no longer trust in the saints, the grace of God. We no longer trust in practice, do we? We've been brainwashed and conditioned into thinking that the pursuit of blindness is the answer. Now, the mass media has disseminated all this, but it came about by quote-unquote the Renaissance in Europe, which means the reemergence of arrogance. The Renaissance was just the reemergence of arrogance, actually, and the pursuit of spiritual blindness. So the world, and then the mass media, the radio, television, the electronics that they have also invented, has disseminated this pursuit of blindness throughout the world. And so the Tibetans realize this. I mean, they have a clearer realization of this than any other culture, culturally. They see it very clearly. It's like, wow, this is the pursuit of spiritual blindness the world is engaged in. Because they were sealed off from the world. They didn't have much contact at all. And now, after 1959, they come out into the world, and it's like, holy cow. And they can hardly believe it. And it's shocking to them. I said, what? We'll give a talk. Let's go give a talk. Get started here. But they don't quite realize how bad it is. You need drastic actions. It's drastically bad. And the prophecies of Jesus Christ and how it's going to go, I believe, are very true. Big trouble. And so we need big picture remedies. Big picture remedies. And the Dharma kings know this. Big picture remedies, including going to another dwelling place is a possibility, actually. Leaving this world altogether is something that Jesus indicated, could very well indicate this is what's going to happen. That the reptilian takeover of this planet, which is really the takeover of the pursuit of spiritual blindness, which the reptilians seem to personify. They're experts at that, or you might say they're extremely derelict. they're cosmic derelicts, actually. They have this intense pursuit of spiritual blindness, and they're taking over this planet. All of this is prophesized in Judeo-Christian tradition. We're very aware of this. So the idea of spreading happiness and peace and enjoying this, but this is very, this seems very odd to us, because Most Christians are expecting to leave this planet. And the idea of spreading happiness, that'll never happen unless there's a culture of spiritual practice of allowing the vision of repentance, of dropping all pursuit of truth. Unless there's a culture of spiritual practice of dropping all pursuit of truth, all pursuit, we will continue to pursue spiritual blindness. We'll continue to follow errors, and there's no possibility of peace with that whatsoever. Zero. As Ram Maharshi said, it's not possible. He said, in this world, there will always be inequalities and all the strife. It's impossible that it could not be that way. Even in Tibet, there was constant strife, tribal strife, fiefdom strife, the history. They didn't have all peace, love, joy, harmony in Tibet, no way. It's always political intrigues. Longchenpa had to flee for his life. They tried to assassinate him. So the idea of spreading peace and joy, this is not possible. What is possible is advocating a practice culture and inspiring those to practice according to what the Holy Spirit shows them how to practice. Remember, we all have access to the Holy Spirit, not just Tibetan Buddhists. Holy Spirit, everyone has access, equal access. Just a matter of using that access. Grace of God is equal for everyone. No one has any special access to it whatsoever. So those who seem to have more access, it's just that they're allowing the access that everyone has. They're not trying to pursue non-access. So these Dharma kings, they know the truth about it all. They say, what are you doing practicing? You already have it. The practice culture is to set down practice. So that's why the great Dakini, who was the consort, spiritual consort of Dharma King Jamyang Khyentse Chogyi Lodro, that's why she showed up here in the West on a street, on a golf course, and laughed at my practice swings. And I was like, wow. This is an incredible experience I had. And she said, what are you doing practicing? Drop all practice. Meaning, the goal of practice is to drop all practice, all pursuit. So I'm trying to, figure out, okay, I got to hit the goal. Now, just step up and hit it. She said, don't practice. Don't practice being it. Be it. This is the transmission. So she gave me a transmission. Somehow she has the capacity to appear in Mauna Kea appearance body. She has that capacity. It's a very profound capacity, to say the least. They all have that, but I had no idea who she was. So it's effective. She's effective in disguises. Only later I figured out who it was. I saw her. Oh, wow. Dakinis are known for appearing. Being able to appear. That's one of the very at ease with that sort of thing. Throughout history, like Tibetan Buddhism, they said that Dakinis appeared to me and gave me this transmission or this clarity, the capacity to appear. Bliss body appearances and the Mauna Kea appearance, somehow that's a capacity. And in Christianity, we term Dakinis angels. So angels will have appeared to Christians throughout history. Many, 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 many appearances throughout history. Saints would say, this angel of the Lord appeared to me just as clear as day. and walked with me and spoke with me like it was a body right there. And then it would disappear in light or something or whatever. So Christians have great familiarity with angels and the appearances of angels. Just the same thing as Dakinis, the same thing as what they're talking about, the Twin Blues. So someone from some tradition should not say, "Hey, adopt my tradition." They should say, "Adopt my work ethic, my practice ethic of setting down practice." Now, the arrogant ones will say, "We're not practicing at all. See, we've already succeeded." No, they're practicing spiritual blindness constantly. There's nobody that practices more than the arrogant ones. They practice nonstop. They put us to shame in terms of practice. Really, they never stop. They have to. In order to maintain this arrogance and not see intrinsic spaciousness, you have to keep yourself brainwashed, so to speak, 24/7. So most people spend their entire life, every instant, practicing arrogance, spiritual blindness. That's their practice. So all we do is we ease off of that practice of spiritual blindness. And intrinsically, naturally, the dawning of a vision of intrinsic spaciousness, it's just there because that's way more natural to us, you see. So we just have to back away from spiritual blindness. Proselytization is business. Of course, these monasteries, retreat houses, everything that's built, cathedrals, churches, that costs a lot of money. I see these retreat places, I say, what? Being aware of the building industry, I say, holy cow, this is very expensive. So, of course they want you to donate. And of course, right? Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that at all. But keep in mind, it is a business as well. There's an economic side to it. Just like, same with Christianity, proselytizing, you go to church, you know, people, that money keeps the church school going, the outreach programs, all that stuff requires money. And the people who are part of that church, they're responsible for funding it all. That's a big part of it. That's a big part of any religion, is the funding of all of these activities. But since I don't have any money, I think that helps me not be part of any religion, any formal institutionalized religion. I'm not part of any institutionalized religion at all. Because I can't help them monetarily at all. I'd like to help all of them. But what's important, what Jesus emphasized and what Jamyang Kinsey Choki Lodro also said, he said, the way it's going now, he said, unfortunately, he realized it's now, the Dharma is going to be on an individual basis instead of a cultural basis. He saw it very clearly. And he said, unfortunately, yeah, I agree. unfortunately. And just because it's unfortunate doesn't mean that it isn't doesn't hasn't happened, and doesn't mean we don't have to get after it. We do have to get after it. So he said it is on a more it's on an individual basis now, more than a cultural basis, which is, of course in miracles is self-study on an individual basis. I did the whole thing on an individual basis. I'm still doing it on an individual basis. Not part of any institution. The institutions don't have the juice anymore, really. It's dissipating. It's vanishing. Because the juice that Tibetan Buddhists had, Buddhism had, is in the culture of practice. And they're so used to being immersed in that, I don't know if they quite understand, well, I probably do, but that the rest of the world doesn't have this culture. And so it's like pouring water into a desert. You know, it's just like, how do you keep this culture? And who said, I think the Dalai Lama said that the Tulku, or someone very prominent said the Tulku tradition is, and it was one of the great Tulkus, said it's dying out. It's probably going to die. He says, might as well die. You know, it's dying out. That's true. So the pursuit of spiritual blindness, which is arrogance, tried to smash and destroy Tibetan, the practice culture, which Tibet represents, tried to smash communist Chinese, who are very much in pursuit of spiritual blindness, wanted to destroy the practice culture that they was most threatening to them. So they tried to destroy Tibetan culture, practice culture, and to a large extent they did. Because we still have the outline of it, but it's not the same practice culture. It's not. I mean, Jemen Kenshi Choki Lodo, he had like 60 different spiritual masters that he got empowerments from, at least. I don't know all the visions he had, it may be thousands. And so they're constantly traveling from one monastery to another, from one master to another. This is the culture there. So every day, you know, you're getting empowerment, you're meeting spiritual masters. Yeah, it's like practice nirvana. But you go out in the rest of the world and it just isn't there at all. It's like a desert. I feel like I've been wandering in a barren desert my whole life. So you have to be like the desert fathers did and hunker down in a little hut or a cave in the desert by a little oasis. And you have to get after it yourself and don't wait for some practice culture to arise, because it's not arising right now here. Just the opposite. So the Tulku tradition, the whole Tibetan tradition, they may very well be dying out. And all you have left is the bare bones of the institution, which is what's happened to Catholicism and Christianity. You know, it's just the outlines, the bones are there. There's a skeleton, and they're animating the skeleton. But the heart of it isn't there anymore, actually. I can tell you this. It's just a skeleton that's there. And we're hauling this skeleton around, you know, just putting a hat on it. Hey, look at this great, you know, I got. What? What's that? The people are just somnolent, you know, and zombie-like. And the priests who keep trying to say, hey, look, you're blowing it. I mean, the society's falling apart. I mean, this is a spiritual holocaust that's happening in the world. There really is a spiritual holocaust happening right here, folks. It's the holocaust of all holocausts. Okay. Not diminishing the other ones that took place, but there's a fact that there's a spiritual holocaust taking place in the world right now. And our attention needs to be on that. What a tragedy it would be if we use the other holocaust to distract our attention away from the spiritual holocaust that's taking place right now. That would be the ultimate tragedy, would it not? That would be empowering the spiritual holocaust. So what do you do when there's a spiritual holocaust taking place? It's already taking place, and it's going to get real bad soon. Really, really, we haven't seen anything yet. So we need to be focused on this. This is the greatest holocaust in history here, a spiritual holocaust, which is what high-speed pursuit of spiritual blindness, being demanded of everyone, being demanded of everyone. Look at the heavy-handed way the Chinese treated Tibetan culture, which is a practice culture. They tried to destroy it, absolutely decimate it. Destroyed all the destroyed the monasteries, executed the monks, put them in prison, burned the books, destroyed the statues of, you know, Padmasambhava and all these great relics and icons that were used to encourage the practice culture. They destroyed as many as they could. They systematically wiped out the whole superstructure of a practice culture, which is what? Encouragement everywhere. Like when I go out, I see a bumper sticker, you know, Jesus loves you, so I say, thank you. This encourages me to keep practicing. This is what we used to have in the West, Judeo-Christianity. Cross on a hill. You're driving the freeway, see a cross on a hill. Thank you for reminding me. Oh, yeah. Let me get back to my practicing of setting all practice down, of all pursuit down. Practicing letting go of pursuit of truth. So that the only way we experience truth is when we stop pursuing it. So these are reminders. This is a practice culture. They have reminders everywhere. A Buddha statue. This is very important. The Dharma kings would encourage all this. The temple here, you know, whatever this. Oh, yeah. You're driving past. Oh, that reminds me. I better get back to my practicing, dropping practice. Letting go of my pursuit of spiritual blindness. I better practice my letting go, meaning I need to get familiar and comfortable with setting down my spiritual pursuit of spiritual blindness. Let me get back to that. That's called a reminder, practice culture. And what they did was they tried to wipe that out. And then they tried to, you know, showcase, well, you're this. But no, they know. You got what you got left is a skeleton. So they're parading the skeleton around now, public relations wise, you know. Oh yeah, Tibet, wonderful place. Happy Buddhists here. It's, you know. Now those are figureheads. There's a skeleton they're parading around. As if we're supposed to be fooled by that. Their purpose was to destroy practice culture, or the culture of practicing, you know, of practicing, the culture of getting familiar with dropping our pursuit of spiritual blindness. This is a clear way to describe it. That's what they were about. And this is what we need to be about. And this is what the arrogance wants to destroy in this world. They'll keep the skeleton around and parade it around till the rest of the cosmos say, well, what a planet Earth, look at this, we got a great religions here. Look at Roman Catholicism, wonderful little skeleton. Yeah. But there's no practice culture, which means getting familiar with dropping the pursuit, letting go of the pursuit of spiritual blindness. Getting familiar with letting go of the pursuit of spiritual blindness. This is what we call practice culture, a Dharma culture. So they try to destroy the Dharma culture. And when you do that, it makes it real tough. It makes it real difficult. It is doable still. You have to pursue it on an individual basis more. And the Tibetans say you can't do it without a guru, without a lama. You can't do it. That's not true, actually. Because the Holy Spirit is the root lama of everyone. But it certainly helps. But to say it's impossible to do otherwise, that just they're in big trouble then, you know, going forward. If that's what they believe. But Jesus told us that the Holy Spirit will guide our path. And these Dharma kings are able to contact us and give transmissions on the subtle bliss body level. So even though we don't meet them in person out and externally in the world, we still get the transmissions. What the Tibetan Buddhists are saying is the Vajrayana path can't be done without a guru or lama, which is probably true. Because of the type of practices are so intense that they need to be really instructed and guided very personally and stuff. But that's not the only path. Vajrayana path is not the only path, not the only fast path there is, actually. So I've gotten help from the Dharma kings my whole life, but I never, you know, met them personally. As far as a Nirmanakaya body, I never had any Nirmanakaya help at all here. So don't, you know, if the Tibetan Buddhists start despairing, don't go with that despair. Or if you start getting a little frustrated, don't go with it. Don't get caught up in that at all, because they might start, you know, like despairing, like the Lama system is broken, the Guru system is broken, transmission lines are being broken, the Tulku system is being broken, the whole thing. There's no help, hope for anyone. You know, that is not true at all. You don't need a Nirmanakaya body guru. You do not. Have faith in the Sambhogakaya guru, okay? And they can visit you. I've had many, 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 many visits from the Sambhogakaya, the bliss body aspect of God's grace in dreams. Called dream yoga, actually. That's a very powerful yoga, dream yoga. And I haven't done any Vajrayana Buddhist practices at all, none. And I just, you know, monitoring things, wowing the clarity that arises, just wowing that keeps you going very fast and smoothly along the path. And the Holy Spirit is orchestrating everything, orchestrating your whole path, orchestrating everyone's path. So I'm just seeing a potential trouble spot here. Is the Tibetans start losing faith, and so many people are putting their faith in them as having, they're the ones who have the answer. If they start losing faith, that could be really disastrous for a lot of people. I'm not losing faith at all. I'm not dependent on that. You know, I'm not dependent on that culture. I'm not dependent on culture for success in terms of letting go of the pursuit of spiritual blindness. I'm not dependent on any particular culture at all. I'm the one. I can practice. Nothing's stopping me from practicing. Nothing at all. Just my own continuity fear is the only thing that's in the way. Nothing else is in the way. So if we just accept this, I have a severe problem, is continuity fear, and the vision of repentance, the vision of oneness is the remedy for that continuity fear ultimately. So I just need to make that my goal, and the way of practice is wow my own clarity. Then I've got the practice right with me wherever I go. I don't need to be in a monastery. I don't need to, you know, be in a guru relationship. I don't need to be in any of that. But all gurus are welcome. All transmissions are welcome. I met Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodo. He came to me on his own accord. In terms of, and I got the transmission of zero momentum from him, you see? Just by meeting with him like that. I felt like, yeah. I understand. I can appreciate this. Zero momentum. That's very useful. That's very helpful, thank you. So I gave like an empowerment, a super helpful empowerment, just through a dream, you see? Just through a dream of meeting him. So I believe we need to, yeah, guru yoga is very helpful, okay? They say all yoga is guru yoga, ultimately. Well, ultimately it's all Holy Spirit yoga, actually. Gurus are just emanations of the grace of God, Holy Spirit. So all yoga is Holy Spirit yoga. This is a great way of looking at it. Very true way. And then the emanations, these bliss body emanations, can come to us in our dreams. So if we all get put in FEMA camps, guess what? These Dharma kings, these bliss body emanations of the Holy Spirit can still visit us in dreams there. And give us these transmissions of tremendous confidence that we too can accept no pursuit of spiritual blindness. That this is the real will of God. This is aligning with the will of God. The will of God's already there. We just need to align with it. We need to set down our pursuit of spiritual blindness. That's all. The bliss body's already there. We need to set down our pursuit. Let go of our pursuit of spiritual blindness. Let go. As Jesus says, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go, which means relax your pursuit of spiritual blindness. Let go of all the thoughts which constitute your pursuit of spiritual blindness. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Let go of your pursuit of spiritual blindness. That's it. That's all you need to do. That's it. Nothing more. But our continuity verse says, well, you know, but what will we pursue then? We're so used to pursuing, So we have to keep evaporating our continuity fear. This is the only practice there is, evaporate your continuity fear. How you do that, it's up to the Holy Spirit and you, right? Ultimately, you know, the superficiality of it, the form that your practice takes, superficial. That's going to be different in everyone's case. This is what I found. So nobody need despair at all. Oh, I can't locate the body of my guru. You know, I'm lost. I've never had a guru in a body here. I'm not lost. They come to you in dreams. They come to you in miracles. They don't have to, their body doesn't have to be present for them to do miracles. And they also can appear, actually. The Dakini aspect is like an appearance aspect in some way. The Nirmanakai appearance. But that was just a grace type of thing that just shocked me. It was like a shock transmission of laughter, this intense laughter at my practicing. It's like, what are you doing practicing? Try to hit nothing. You know, just hit the golf ball. What are you doing? Just be the bliss body. Don't try to practice the bliss body, and you know, just be it. So there was some profound, you know, realization I had there. I've explained it a number of times. So they can appear, yeah, but the appearance in dreams is just as profound, if not more so. So under no circumstances despair in this world. Just the opposite. Say, no, I'm actually, the fact that I'm so desperate means I'm calling upon the grace of God even more than ever, which means I'm being even more willing to let go of the pursuit of spiritual blindness. And this, all I need to do is keep with this willingness to let go of my pursuit of spiritual blindness. That's it. Now we could practice that constantly. Doesn't matter if we're in a FEMA camp or not. Doesn't matter if we're in prison. The Chinese imprisoned a lot of Tibetan monks. But they, you know what? They kept practicing. I'm sure that their gurus appeared to them in dreams and visions, etc. Right? Of course they can. The gurus can contact us no matter what. Nothing prevents them from contacting us. Nothing whatsoever except our own pursuit of spiritual blindness. So as long as we're willing to set that down and wow the setting, letting go of it. We've got to wow the letting go of it, because it is really quite a shock to us. We thought that this is the will of God, and it's the only way to happiness, and we're setting it down. We're not used to setting down pursuit. It's like, wow, I'm not pursuing anything. Holy cow, what's going to happen to me? Wow, it's just so wowish. It's just so shocking. So we have to be willing to wow the shock of it. 360 degree, just sit in this no pursuitness. 360 degree non-pursuit. Okay, 360 degree non-pursuit. Now there are some who are, you might say, they like to put this practice into more form or something. So they go through rituals. They say, oh, I need to put my hands like this. I need to do this. I need to do this. No, you don't need to do any of that. And probably the less of that you do, the better. Really. because that's still, you know, it's part, that's like putting the wow into form, which is crystallizing. It's better just to do nothing, just sit quietly. That's even better. That's more wowish. That's even better than rituals. It's more direct. It's quicker. Because there are many who, whatever teaching you give them, they're going to just automatically start producing endless rituals. Oh, yeah, yeah, okay, we'll do this, we make this movement now, and then this movement, we go through this series of movements, and then like this, and then we wow it like this, and then we touch our head 10 times, we go like this. This is all nervousness. Of like, I need some structure, I need some structure, I need some pursuit structure. I want to feel there's something to pursue. Well, they're pursuing the ritual. It's way better to just do nothing, just sit here like this, just don't do any ritual. Just feel the wow. A huge bell has been rung, gonged, wham, boom. The whole valley is reverberating. Wherever you are, just feel the all space is reverberating with this intense reverberation. You don't have to call it sound. It's intense reverberation. And you just sit there in shock and don't do anything. Don't even move. Don't even pursue non-movement, okay? Don't move and don't pursue non-movement. Just 360-degree non-pursuit. And have faith that this reverberations will smooth out. Gradually it all starts, the whole atmosphere starts smoothing out, right? Right now the atmosphere is just reverberating, but gradually it will smooth out. Jianyuan Kenshi Chogyi Lodro did this, purification of near the Hasan or near Samye Monastery or somewhere, some really important place. And he did this Vajra thing, and the people that were there, those who were there, the monks that were there, his devotees were, they reported that it was a beautiful calm day and an intense storm arose. Clouds came. Super strong wind, hideous dust storm, and it was just this violent commotion. And then after the ceremony was done, okay, gradually it all smoothed out, became intensely peaceful. Okay. This is a perfect example of what we do here in terms of and what you can do. You flip the script, flip the script, flip the script. You're working on saying no pursuit of spiritual blindness, no pursuit. I'm letting go of all pursuit of spiritual blindness. I'm clearly seeing it. This causes this wow, shock of the landscape of our expectations becomes profoundly shocked because our expectations are extremely wrapped up in this pursuit of spiritual blindness. The whole world is fanatically wrapped up in a cocoon of expectations of this is their destiny. And so suddenly we see this is not my destiny. All these expectations that I will be pursuing spiritual blindness, that's not my destiny at all. So the whole landscape changes. And so there's a commotion in our mind. There's this massive commotion. It's like a dust storm, windstorm, whatever. So we just sit there in calm confidence that we did this intentionally. And this is actually dissipating all this latent expectations of destiny, or karma, you call it. Massive release of this karma is taking place because it's really karma is just our expectations that we've been developing to pursue spiritual blindness. That's all it is. Massive dissipation of this in the ringing of the bell, this reverberation. Just be confident. It'll all calm down and smooth out. If you just sit there and don't panic, remain very confident. The wow is this very confident state. But you're not moving because there's this intense sandstorm and dust storm happening. You're just, okay. And then after a while, guess what? It all calms down. And it's like, oh, wow. You just liberate. As Jesus says, you just saved yourself hundreds of years of suffering. He puts it that way. He doesn't use the term karma. It's the same thing, though. He says delay. He uses the term delay. The Eastern term is karma. It's just delay. Because all you're doing is delaying the inevitable. That's all. Karma is just the delay of the inevitable. which is acceptance that we can't change reality. Reality still is exactly as it always is, and that's everything's perfect still. That's the inevitable. There's no way to ever make it not inevitable. So all we're doing, Jesus says, we're wandering about aimlessly in delay. That's it. Fanatically pursuing spiritual blindness to keep delaying. So when we do this flipping of the script and affirmations, tremendous amount of karma is released, tremendous amount of delay is released. And this changes our expectations, because we thought we're going to be delaying all this, you know, we have these expectations, which is delay, and now they're gone. And so I just say, oh my gosh, what am I going to do with myself? You know, wow, this is a different landscape. But I like it, it's better, but it's different. So better is still different right off the bat, always. Always, right? Better is still different right off the bat. So we need to recognize this. Say, yeah, this is better, but I have these temporary jitters because it's different. Consciously sit quietly with these jitters until they subside and start wearing off. You have to make that conscious effort. But just relax, hang loose with it. The jitters will gradually dissipate and smooth out. This is the way to make very smooth, rapid progress. Is you're evaporating your karma. You're evaporating your delay. You're evaporating your continuity fear. All karma is based on continuity fear. All delay is based on our continuity fear of like, yeah, this is better, but it's not the same how I'm used to. That's continuity fear. Ultimately, I mean, the vision of intrinsic space, it's so wonderful. It's so much better that the continuity fear jumps out of, whoa, you know, this is so great, but I'm not used to it. What the heck? Yeah. So we have to keep working at this continuity fear. There's no choice in it. And this is not an inferior path at all. Not at all. There's no need to even compare. There's no need. It works. It's a great path. It's in that echelon where you don't need to compare. You can reach, wherever you reach this echelon where I don't feel any need to compare at all. I was reading something about these drag races these guys used to have back in the 60s in Southern California. There's a lot of drag races, and maybe other places around the country and world, but that was the culture. And you drag race for your pink slips to the car, actually. That's what they did. And you know, everybody was trying to trick out their car, so they had the fastest car, fastest set of wheels in town. And the pink slip was your ownership certificate to the car. And so they drag race for pink slips. And sometimes it'd be two out of three. Sometimes you have two out of three. And whoever won the other drag race, two out of three, the other guy would have to sign his pink slip that signed the ownership of the car, and he'd lose his car. That's what they did. Pretty intense. Very intense. And so this guy was talking about his experience with that, and someone said, had a certain car, and he said, hey, I'll race you for a pink slip. I think my car can beat yours. And he said, what do I want your car for? I don't want your car. I'm happy with my car. You know, so what if your car's fast? Mine's really fast too. I mean, we reach a certain point where, you know, I can hit 150 or whatever. I mean, look, dude, you know, my set of wheels is really, really fast. And so I don't need another set of wheels. I don't need a drag race. I don't need your car. I don't need your car. Mine's really fast, too. What would you do with a second car? A headache, extra insurance, more upkeep. Where are we going to store it? You know, maintenance of it. No, I mean, why would you want two fast cars? I mean, if you got one that's just uber fast, you know what? That's good enough. And you don't really want one that goes too fast, right? Because then it gets reckless and dangerous. But if you got a car that you feel is just super powerful, super mega powerful, that is just screaming fast, and it's got a great style and stuff, why do I want to be pink slip racing somebody else and beat him? I don't want to lose my car, and I don't want to gain someone else's car. So I'm just sticking with my car. You know, it's got, if it had a set of wings, it would fly. I mean, it's basically, it's fast enough to fly, and that's all the speed you need. So what are we arguing over here? It's just arrogance. It's ridiculous. It's just trying to develop momentum, right? Believe in momentum. Got zero momentum. This car's already got zero momentum. What do I need another car with zero momentum for? This is redundant. This is what Longchenpa tells us, redundant. He emphasizes, look, don't be stupid, and get into redundancy. He says, that's really failure, you know. It's all redundant. Trying to acquire bliss body is redundant. Trying to do all these practices is redundant. Trying to generate anything is redundant. The bliss body is already generated by the Holy Spirit. What are we doing trying to generate it? Now, what we're really doing is familiarity practice. But if we understand this, then it's fine. But Longchenpa is pointing out the highest perspective, saying, yes, but be aware that it's redundant and accept the shock of this redundancy. And therefore, I can ultimately drop all this practice because it's actually completely redundant. But we keep practicing because of our Kundalini fear. This is a fact. So all this practice we're doing, was it Vajrayana Buddhism, whatever, it's all because of our Kundalini fear. Ultimately, it's not needed at all. The bliss body is already there, perfect. God created it perfect for us. God, the Holy Spirit, created it perfect for us. Put it there. It's an expression. It's a pragmatic expression. It's there for everyone in perfect shape. The Holy Spirit will keep it in perfect shape for all of us forever, as long as we need it. So there's nothing we need to do to generate it at all. There's no such thing as generating the bliss body. This is very important to hear this. No such thing whatsoever. It's already there, completely immaculately perfect for us. In Christianity, you call it the Immaculate Virgin. The Virgin Mary, the bliss body. That's Christian symbiology. Most people don't understand this. The pagans use that to go towards mother worship, which is arrogance, is listening to the voice of arrogance, which is, let's pursue, you know, spiritual blindness through all the rituals of the flesh that arrogance has for us. So that's a slippery slope. But the Immaculate Virgin is the bliss body that's generated by the Holy Spirit and is always perfect. There's nothing we can do to tarnish it in the slightest bit. There's nothing we can do in our pursuit of spiritual blindness, in any practice we do, to tarnish the bliss body in any way. It's always immaculate. It's always immaculate. Now, if I was talking to people at some place, you know, the audience or something, I'd be saying the same thing. People will be spending 2.5 hours with that. So this is the same thing as giving a talk if you were present here in some auditorium. It's the same thing. So I hope you're listening to 2.5 hours because the whole thing is just chock full of familiarity practice. This is the only practice there is familiarity practice. That's it. This is what we're really doing, whether it's Vajrayana, generation and completion and all the various mantra, this and that. They're just practicing getting used to the fact that the bliss body is already there for all of us, and it's immaculately perfect. There's nothing we need to do to make it perfect. And Longchenpa is there telling us, hey, all practitioners, look, this is the real truth. It's already there. You're not doing anything to establish it or generate it whatsoever. You're just getting familiar with the fact that it's already there. Wow, it's already there. What they do is they try to bring it into their themselves, like imagine that there's the, imagine here's the bliss body, visualize it, and then imagine it's entering into them and purifying all their karma. Well, this is a very valid technique, I would say, if they really culturally and truly have it in 360 degree context. But this is sort of the essence of Vajrayana Buddhism, is sort of imagining the bliss body with all all these qualities. That's why I have these tankas, these all these, you know, to help them practice visualization. Their whole culture is a culture of visualization. So of course, it's empowered, they can do it. But our culture is not like that at all. So for me, it's like the idea of doing that. I said, what? It's like asking me to fly or something. I can't do that. I don't feel any capacity to do that kind of visualization at all. But culturally, I've been working at it for so long that for them it's just like as easy as, you know, very natural. Just like, easy workout. But they visualize bliss body in various formats, you know, whatever you call it, this Tara or, you know, Manjushri or, you know, there are all sorts of different names and labels they can give it in different forms and different colors and different aspects and things. Visualize the bliss body and then visualize it entering into our body. You visualize it entering into our body. And as it enters in, it's you feel purifying all the chakras, they say the centers and various things like that. And it can get very technical and detailed. You start talking about the subtle channels and the chakras. And the, you know, it can end up being super complicated. You know? It doesn't have, but I guess, you know, they enjoy, you know, it's a way to spend time to, you know, to keep them practicing. You know, it's continuity fear saying, well, what do I do next? I'm not quite ready to actually realize that it's already there in immaculate condition. So I need to make it purify this and that and do this and this and this and that. And that. That is all just the dance of continuity fear ultimately. We're already realized. The bliss body is already there. It's just a dance of familiarity. We do this dance of familiarity, do the familiarity dance. And this dance can be done in many, many different ways. The familiarity dance. So don't feel inferior if you're not doing, you know, this visualization and all this stuff. Don't feel inferior at all. I mean, you do your familiarity dance the way the Holy Spirit indicates it for you. Just make sure you're doing it all as much as possible. That's the real key. Doesn't, you know, whatever it is, what your dance of familiarity dance is, whether it's the boogie or the watusi or the frug or the twist or the watusi or the shingling or the disco, but whatever your dance of familiarity is, just make sure you're doing it as much as possible. That's the real key to it all. That's the real key. That's why practice culture, which is why these Tibetan Buddhists are very helpful for people in that way. It is shaming us by their practice. Shaming us by their practice. They're just doing their familiarity dance in the way that they're used to. That's fine. But don't be worried if your familiarity dance really doesn't have anything in common with their familiarity dance. Someone's doing the twist and someone's, you know, doing the shimmy or something, you know, or the swim. Someone's doing the swim. Do the swim. And the chubby checkers say, come on, baby, let's do the twist. Yeah, just like this. And do that. Remember when everybody was doing the twist? If you're old enough, it was a mania. Everybody's doing the twist. Come on, yeah, let's twist again, like we did last summer. Right? I think this song came out, Let's Twist Again. Because dance manias happen in the world all the time. There's constantly dance manias. And so what we're doing, our life is really a dance of continuity fear. And as we're evaporating the continuity fear, that dances too. Our evaporation on spiritual path, we're a dance of evaporating our continuity fear through familiarity with the fact that the bliss body is already there for us, completely immaculate. There's nothing we can do to harm it, to make it less functional, to make it less what it is. We can't touch it as far as changing it at all. It's a perfect red Ferrari in our driveway, and it will always be immaculate. Every time we go out to that driveway, that red Ferrari is in absolute perfect condition. And there's not a speck of maintenance we need to do on it. It's self-maintaining perfectly. This is a fact. So we have to do the dance of evaporating our continuity fear in different ways. different cultures, different backgrounds, this unique, our pursuit of spiritual blindness. Every pursuit is unique, actually. It's all kind of variations. The way we dance is, nobody dances exactly the same. So we've been dancing this pursuit of spiritual blindness. And so as we undance it, as we get used to evaporating that continuity fear dance, our dances will be unique. So we don't need to institutionalize it totally. And of course, Tibetan Buddhism with the guru system, the gurus work in all different ways with your uniqueness, which is why they say we need a guru who really understands your uniqueness. Yes, but we can just accept the uniqueness for ourselves, right? And say, it's okay, Holy Spirit's got my back. And the way that I do it is the way that I'm going to do it. And just make sure we do it as much as possible. In fact, all constantly, if we, you know, work towards constantly. This is Sri Sri Anandamayi's advice, the root advice she gave. Again, there's no greater guru than Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. Never been, never will be one that's greater. And her root advice was practice constantly and move towards constant practice. That's her essential root advice why she came. Practice constantly. She says, you think I came as a mother just to let you slack off? Just the opposite. My advice is practice, move towards practicing constantly. Do your dance of continuity, fear, evaporation constantly, whatever it is. She didn't tell anybody to change their culture. She said, Christians, great. She said, be a great practicing Christian. Practice your Christianity constantly. She'd say, if you're your Islam, practice your Islam constantly. She was totally ecumenical. You're Tibetan Buddhist, practice your Tibetan Buddhism constantly. You're Hindu, this, practice your Hinduism constantly. Okay? Because these are all just dances of evaporating continuity, fear. So do it constantly. Move towards doing it constantly. This is her essential heart advice to everyone. That's all we're saying. We're just passing on this essential heart advice. It's the same in all cases. Practice your dance of letting go of the pursuit of spiritual blindness. All pursuit is the pursuit of spiritual blindness, actually. All of it. So that's why I say that the spiritual materialism is very dangerous. The yoga girl, spiritual materialism is very, because they're saying, look, pursuit is great. You just put spiritual labels on it, it's fine. No, it's not fine. The real spiritual path is letting go of all pursuit. All pursuit is the pursuit of spiritual blindness. Because we only recognize the bliss body, which is a reflection of what we really are, when we drop all pursuit of it. So as long as we're pursuing, if you call the pursuit yoga, this is leading us astray. Okay, whatever you call the pursuit. Our practice is practicing letting go, getting familiar, letting go of all pursuit. Full stop in the wow of no pursuit. 360 degree no pursuit. That's the real practice. The practice letting go of familiar, practicing getting familiar with letting go of all pursuit. Whereas the spiritual materialists are saying, arrogance is saying, we got the answer. Just pursue spirituality and you'll be fine. This is a lie. That's the lie of arrogance. Because that's not real spirituality at all. That's false. Okay, so that's spiritual materialism. That's superficial. Pursue. But they want you to pursue. And as long as you're pursuing, of course, you're just blinding yourself to the nowness of intrinsic spaciousness. This is what Longchenpa says. He says, this is what Ramaharshi says. You could pursue all the spirituality, but you're missing it. The nowness of it's right. Truth is here right now. You must immerse yourself. You must lose yourself in this. He says you must let go of everything you think you know and have learned and be immersed and lose yourself in this. Truly, be that. No pursuit at all. So the spiritual materialists seem to be very spiritual, but they do not have this awareness that we're talking about here at all. They might label it blah, 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 but they're not really practicing it. They're not really practicing the familiarity of letting go of all pursuit, including the positive, the negative. It doesn't matter. Pursuing the positive is just as blinding as pursuing the negative. It's just as spiritually blinding. So they're trying to emphasize positivity, positivity. What we're emphasizing is super positivity of the already here-ness of the bliss body, which we only experience when we drop all pursuit of it. Completely different emphasis. So, again, the positivity of the yoga girl, spiritual materialism, all this kind of stuff is ruinous. I mean, this is blinding us to our realization, blinding us to the bliss body, to spiritual truth, blinding us to it. It's a glamorous way of blinding ourselves. It's a glamorous way of blinding ourselves. And believe me, the suffering that comes from that will be just as vicious as the suffering that comes from a non-glamorous blinding of ourselves, if not worse, because we'll say, what's wrong with me? We'll put even heavier guilt trip on ourselves. So the mother, a mother's not the answer. The mother always right, no. The mother always says, pursue, but pursue positive goal. No, that's pursuing spiritual blindness. Whether you say it's a positive goal or a negative goal, it's still pursuing spiritual blindness. It's avoiding the bliss body. It's arrogance. The bliss body is already in everyone's driveway. There's no pursuit needed at all. And as soon as you say, no, I need to really pursue a lot of positive stuff so I can earn that bliss body, that's spiritual blindness. And you never, that never resolves itself. It only ends up in towards mental chaos, actually, because the ego will leverage that pursuit towards mental chaos. Whether you're pursuing something positive, you'll be shocked. You say, I'm pursuing all this positivity and I end up with mental chaos. How is that possible? Well, we've just explained how it's possible. And this is what we're warning everyone against here. And the Dharma King, of course they know this, all this. We're about done with the video, aren't we? Yeah. So again, the key advice is to do your dance of evaporating continuity fear, which is everything we said in the video, is to keep practicing it more, or focusing on it more, or accepting it more, wowing the grace that arises. As you accept that there's no letting go of all pursuit, which is all pursuits to pursue the spiritual blindness. As you practice accepting this, the grace will dawn upon you, and it will produce a wow in you. Wow, I'm really succeeding. This is really amazing. My expectations have just changed. My karma, I just let go of so much karma. I let go of so much delay. Holy cow, I'm going to be driving that Ferrari really soon. This is a wow shock. So then let the reverberations die down on their own accord. Don't struggle with trying to make them die down. Just be very confident they'll die down. It's already released. It's just I have to get used to this new landscape. Less delay, less delay, less delay, less delay. I just have to get used to that less delay. Wow. Again, everything we're doing here, less delay, less delay, and then getting used to that less delay, less delay. Gotta get used to it. I have to get used to it. It's like, wow. Last night I was so wowed. I said, oh my gosh, I don't know what I'm going to do with myself. It was the most beautiful night imaginable. It was just awesomely beautiful night. There was this light in the sky, this like yellowish orange light on the horizon. I said, what the heck is that? And it was twinkling. Wow, it was very bright. And then as I started to look at it, it started disappearing, started fading. And then I told someone, hey, there's this light, check it out. When they came to look at it, it disappeared. It disappeared. And I said, what? Was that a plane? How could a plane, it was a great distance away. How could a plane produce a light that bright and be steady and twinkling like that? I don't know what it was. I thought it was Venus, but no, Venus was up there, I thought. But how could Venus disappear like that? It was really quite an experience. But the night, the evening was just, oh, God, it was so serene. It was surreally beautiful here in California, the evening, last night. And tonight may be the same. Yeah. The air, you could bottle and drink it. It was like an elixir. It was just potent elixir. Wow. They said it would be beautiful, and it was. And a full moon, too. A full moon arose. Oh, wow. So, I like living in constant wellness. It just the grace of God is just potent. Less delay, less delay, less delay, less delay, less delay. Bliss body. Ferrari's right there. In perfect shape. Just see it and go, wow. It's in perfect shape. Tell yourself that. It's not rusty and because it's been sitting in your driveway unused. No. It's in flawless condition. It'll purr like a kitten when you turn it on, turn the engine on. Everything will be just immaculately functional in the bliss body. Immaculately functional. There's nothing you need to do to maintain that at all. Tell yourself that. Nothing I need to do to maintain its perfect condition.